Have a few words from Mr. DiBiase by tape, videotape.
We do indeed. Let's go now to this exclusive interview with the man whose suspension has been lifted, Ted DiBiase, and he videotaped these comments for a release at this time.
World Championship Wrestling. First you fine me, now you suspend me for 5 weeks, thinking that it's going to put a cramp in my style. Well, let me tell you something. I'm a man in championship wrestling, in a wrestling world that can go any place I want to go with my ability. I'm wanted all over the world, and I have an open contract right now to go to Japan. So I'll just go to Japan for 5 weeks, but I'll be back. And when I come back, I'm going to pick up right where I left off. I told you people that I was going to hurt Tommy Rich, and that's exactly what I did. I do what I say I'm going to do. And I've got another man in mind when I get back. And when I come back, I'll hurt him too. If it has to be in the confines of that ring and to keep myself from being suspended further, then that I can do. I am the greatest scientific wrestler you've ever seen. But the difference in Ted DiBiase now, as I told you people before, is that I don't care about being Mr. Nice Guy. Whatever it takes, anything it takes to win, to put that money in the palm of my hand, is exactly what I'm going to do. Where is Tommy Rich right now? He's laid out somewhere wondering what happened to him because he's a nice guy. Well, this is not a nice guy anymore. You're looking at a champion. You're looking at a winner. And when I come back, people, I'm coming back to stay. And oh, yes, naturally, I'm number one. And I'm going to be number one here and everywhere that you can see this space on World Championship Wrestling. So I'll take my suspension. I'll go to Japan. I'll go wherever else they want me, because I am in big demand, and when I come back, I'll be back to stay.
Well, of course, he did, in fact, go to Japan, and I might point out that that shows the kind of resolution this man has, and obviously, he's not here today, but I hear he's on his way.
Well, we expect him any moment, I'm sure. I don't know when he'll arrive. We haven't had any word officially from Ted DiBiase, but I do understand that his tour is over in Japan. And he talks about the many places that he can go. I have no doubt that there are a lot of places that would might like to have a wrestler of his caliber. But I also question the way he wrestles. I'm also concerned about the things that he's done in the past. We'll be watching very closely for Ted DiBiase's return. I think this time, though, we're going to be watching him in the way that he's going to have to wrestle. He's going to have to wrestle according to the rules and the regulations that are placed upon him. And anything else won't be tolerated. We'll send him back to Japan.
Sunday, November 6th at 8:30, championship night for the NWA World Heavyweight title. Harley Race, 7 times world champion, defends the belt against Wildfire Tommy Rich, himself a former world champion, with special referee Pistol Pez Whatley. National Tag Team Championship, the Road Warriors champions against the American Dream, Mr. Charisma Dusty Rhodes, and his partner, National Heavyweight Champion Brett Wayne. The Incredible Man from Sudan, Abdullah the Butcher, against the Mad Dog, Buzz Sawyer. The Great Kabuki takes on Boogie Woogie Man Jimmy Valiant. National TV title, Ron Garvin against Jake the Snake Roberts, plus 2 other matches. Sunday the 6th, the Omni. Be there!
The National Tag Team Champions going out against Ben Terrell and the Black Drums Chief Joe Lightfoot. Lightfoot very quickly hurtled out of the ring. Terrell, who's out of Alabama, has a background of high school wrestling and Golden Gloves boxing, played football, but Rusty is being overpowered right now by these road runners. And I mean they are punishing him. He's giving away some weight here and some size, but he has just had no opportunity whatsoever to move against them. Almost tore his head off with that one. And the Road Warriors just continue to pulverize any and all opponents they step into the ring with. They have a full body slam. The Road Warrior with a clubbing right hand to the side of the jaw. Tell you one thing, Terrell has proven he can take a punch because he has been punished unmercifully thus far in this very, very short match. And he has taken everything they've had to offer so far. Uh-oh, there they go. Oh. Mercifully made the tag. Chief Joe Lightfoot staggers the Road Warrior. Lightfoot exploding with tomahawk chops. And now the Road Warriors retaliating. They were stunned momentarily, no question about that. But now they begin to dominate the situation once again. These men are like redwood trees.
They're more than that. They're like mountains. They're two of the biggest men in wrestling. I don't know what in the world's going to be done with them. And they're just getting smarter all the time. They're doing those tags in and out, which are so essential to be a good tag team. They've got that brute strength. They've got the size. They're gaining that wrestling ability, which they apparently didn't have to the extent that they do now. They talk about being in the bars in Chicago, and I'm sure that they beat a lot of people just with their brute strength. But now they're getting some sophistication to their wrestling. They're watching the count. They're both in there at the same time on occasion, but if you watch real closely, they get out. One gets out before the count of five. So technically, there's nothing that can be done.
No, they're staying just within the limitations. No question about that. An elbow now down to the pectoralis majors of Chief Cho Lightfoot and referee Strapping McGowan, sending the Road Warrior back to his proper corner. Now Lightfoot fires back, but catches the knee to the side of the head. And Lightfoot, a tomahawk chop, rolls over, makes the tag with Ben Terrell. Terrell, as he came through the ropes, was beset upon by the Road Warriors, and again, they have him completely under control.
A kid like that, I would hesitate to wonder why he would want to run the
And that one almost tore the body in half. We might get a chance to see that in the slow motion, and if we do, you'll see what I'm talking about. The impact of that massive
force. 8:30, bull rope match, the American dream, the tower of power, Dusty Rhodes clashes with the Mad Dog, Buzz Sawyer, and for this match, Paul Ellering will be chained to Tommy Rich. National Heavyweight Championship, Jake the Snake Roberts goes after the belt held by Brett Wayne. The Road Warriors clash with Wildfire Tommy Rich and Pistol Pez Watley, plus two other matches tonight. Cincinnati, be there.
Snake is one of the greatest wrestlers in the world today. A man who every time he gets into the ring wrestles with about the same amount of conscience as a fox in a chicken farm. Now the world is a demented society, and Jake has had problems communicating with society. But Precious Paul fully understands all the ramifications and stipulations of contracts. So Jake, I have for you two contracts, one for the World Heavyweight Television title and one for the National Heavyweight Championship.
This man can do it so well. He handles the paper problems, the things that I have trouble with. Right here, I have no problems, which I will show you, Soli.
With my insidious mind, Jake the Snake will go to the top of wrestling.
Now let's take a look at Jake the Snake Roberts in action, and we'll go to the ring. I might point out that the one contract for the National Heavyweight Championship, I understand, will be on television here on World Championship Wrestling next week. One fall, a one-hour time limit. So whatever you do, make your plans to be watching World Championship Wrestling next week. As you see, the National Heavyweight Championship on the line. Jake the Snake Roberts going against the National Heavyweight Champion, who is, of course, Brett Wayne. One fall, 1 hour. Good kip-up by Mike Jackson. Jackson driven back into the turnbuckle that time by Jake the Snake Roberts. Good move by Jackson, and Roberts down. Jackson back up on his feet very quickly. And Jake the Snake having his problems coping with that. Well, Jake the Snake closes in again, taking advantage of Mike Jackson's momentary lapse as he was looking toward Precious Paul Ellering. Now, that's a bad combination, in my opinion. Paul Ellering and Jake the Snake Roberts. Roberts, of course, does have a bit of a communications problem with society, and Ellering obviously is going to handle that aspect of it and let Mr. Roberts handle everything in the room. Look at the way he hooks the arm and then hooks the chin at the same time. Jake the Snake. There you see Paul Ellering. And he's showing the marks of the battle he had with Ole Anderson. Ole explained it rather well, however. That can jam the hips and the spine. I think Ole explained quite well the fact that how these men as professional athletes have to go out and compete even though they are in great pain. I know many times I've seen Dusty Rhodes when it amazed me when I knew what pain he was suffering, and yet he'd get in the ring and give that 110% that is so critical. And it is Mike Jackson right now taking the brunt of a full body slam.
Give it up.
Underhooks the arm, then crosses the. Keeping that chin twisted, and Ellering outside the ring, taunting Mike Jackson. As long as he doesn't touch him, he's all right. Paul Ellering. Initially out of Melrose, Minnesota. Mike Jackson now beginning to explode and has Jake the Snake Roberts in trouble. No question about this. Mike Jackson beginning to... Roberts struck like a cobra. High backdrop that has Jackson in trouble. So Roberts, who looked like he was being stung by a mongoose, suddenly struck back. Jackson powers out before the count. Jackson, a ripping right hand to the side of the jaw. Catches him with a boot to the midsection. High hip toss by Jake the Snake Roberts. Six feet four, about 250 pounds, and Jackson coming off the rope. Jackson to an inside cradle. Roberts powers out. Roberts struck. Jackson again gets it. Lariat by Roberts that time. DDT. Brother, does that jam the head in the spine? Count of three, it is all over. It is all over. We'll see if we're going to get a chance to see that in slow motion. All right, wrestling sources.
Got enough, Gordon Solo, Cincinnati, Ohio. Dusty Rhodes, you're the one and only. But I'm the Mad Dog, and I'm the one and only. We're going to get it on in Cincinnati, Ohio, Dusty Rhodes, because I'm bringing everything that the Mad Dog has. And then when I take care of you in a Crimson Tide, and I leave you laying on the floor as Doolittle the Butcher, you're supposed to be the meanest, the baddest thing that ever walked. If you're looking at the Mad Dog, Butcher, you're looking at the Mad Dog, Dusty Rhodes. You're looking at the man that the world championship.
Riverfront Coliseum tonight in Cincinnati. 8:30 in Cincinnati at Riverfront Coliseum.
Tommy Rich, everybody thinks that you being handcuffed to me is a big deal.
Well, we'll just see how big a deal it is in Cincinnati tonight. Talk to me, Jim.
Don't you just love it? Athens, Ohio, you're going to love it. Huntington, West Virginia, you love it. Huh? Don't you like to see something a little bit different? Well, here it is. So why don't you come on and see what the snake can do? And now that I have this
Battle Creek, Michigan, we're coming your way.
Cincinnati. And the American Dream, Dusty Rhodes, tonight in Cincinnati. And the Mad Dog, Buzz Sawyer, in the blue trunks, getting set to move out against Bob Brown. Now, here are two men who are very, very similar in body structure.
Well, they are. Both men are very heavily built. Bob Brown has been mentioned many times with the shoulders and the chest. But look at Buzz Sawyer. Buzz Sawyer is also a tremendous amateur wrestler. And I sometimes think of him as a guy that maybe just took the wrong road, because He's got a lot of wrestling ability, we know that. He's got that vitality. I think I mentioned to you, Vim Vigor and vitality. And certainly Buzz Sawyer's got that. The direction, with the help of Paul Ellering, I don't agree with, but you can't deny that Buzz is a heck of a competitor.
No question about it. Paul Ellering now adding to his stable, if you will, by picking up Jake the Snake Roberts. And that would be an interesting tag team combination, Snake Roberts and Buzz Sawyer.
Well, it would be. And maybe a combination like that might be interesting going against somebody like the national tag team champions, the Road Warriors. That would be an interesting situation.
I wonder if we'll ever be fortunate enough to see that. I was also thinking about... the combination of Brett Wayne and D. Rhodes facing this kind of a combination.
Well, again, when you start mentioning names, all of a sudden we've come up with several different teams and combinations that could prove to be very exciting. The one thing you look at here, no matter what we think about Buzz Sawyer, we mentioned so many times to control your man, certainly Buzz Sawyer does that. Probably as well, if not better than anybody.
No question about it, and he also uses the legs extensively. The legs, of course, being the strongest muscles in the body. A forearm, a rabbit punch to the back of the head, and then drives the knee into the deltoids of Bob Brown. And Brown coming up rather slowly. Brown fires to the midsection. Sawyer fires back. All right, again, grapevining with the leg, and it is... it is Sawyer maintaining control of Bob Brown, keeping him on the mat. Remember, this match is one fall with a 10-minute time limit. Referee is Nick Patrick, who is a fine athlete in his own right, no question about that. I was talking to... internationally famous Jeff Dragster Doug Rose yesterday, and the consensus of opinion was that this man, Buzz Sawyer, is as dangerous a competitor as been in the ring in a long, long time, and he is certainly proving his point here with a total front chancery on Brown, keeping Brown very much under control.
That's what you got to do. That's the mark of a good wrestler. Buzz Sawyer may be a little misdirected, and he's got some problems of his own, I'm sure. But as we say, what he's doing...
Brown hurtled out, and he came down on his hip and his leg, and it amazes me that he's even able to get to his feet. He is having his problems coming up, and he is really favoring that leg. He came down right on those femoris muscles and the point of the hip, and he's back into the ring, but he is not moving.
He's in a lot of trouble. He's stunned. He's the guy that's just operating on pure instinct right now. You can see that look on his face, Gordon. We're not too far away from him, and looking in his eyes, they've just turned to glass. I think Sawyer right now could beat him, but instead he's going to make sure that when Brown gets done with this match, he'll remember for a long, long time that he was against a guy that could beat him and is really fun.
Precious Paul Ellering standing by, watching impassively. Belly to back to play in a high bridge. Got the count of three. Got the count of three. Perhaps we'll see that again in slow motion. I don't know. If they haven't, we will. Yes. All right. Watch him very carefully. Now, Brown completely dazed, completely staggered. And it's Sawyer in behind his man. Notice the low center of gravity. Caught him from the waist. High, high. Belly to back souple. Then bridges up very quickly, driving Brown's shoulders to the mat and scores the pinfall. Tokyo, Japan, and see Harley Race in action. Well, I guess we're going to take us a second or two to get to Tokyo. There we are.
It's a long way away, Gordon.
It is indeed. All right, we're hearing the introductions being made at this time.
NWA 世界ヘビー級チャンピオン、ハンサムハリー・レイ。 さあこの試合今試合終わりましたジャイアント馬場選手にも放送席に来ていただきまして解説をお願いしたいと思います
All right, the announcer now describing the situation. Jumbo Tsuruta going up against Harley Race. I might point out that, of course, in Tokyo, Japan, and throughout the entire country of Japan, it's not unusual for 30, 40, and 60,000 people to be on hand for title match.
Well, they have the capacity. They wrestle a lot in the outdoor stadiums, and whereas we wrestle indoors, so there's a little bit of difference in that respect. But on occasion, I think that you down in Tampa have wrestled in the Tampa Stadium and put that type of numbers in the stadium. For us, the World Championship, for the most part, we're wrestling in the arenas, and so 10, 12, or 15,000 people is the norm.
And a doggone good norm, I might add, too, is an average is Tsuruta. And exactly, the as you heard the commentator just say, it looked bad for a moment for the champion, but Race was able to bring those knees up just in time. Notice the host of attendants around Tsuruta. He is clearly the favorite in Japan, and everybody there that night was hopeful that he was going to be able to take that world title away from Harley Race. But Race is a man of fantastic intensity.
Well, we talk about people coming back. There's no question when we're talking about a man like Harley Race having won that world title seven different times. He's the definition of being able to come back. He meets an awful lot of competitors all over the world. When you're traveling like he does to Europe and to Africa and to South America, to the Asian countries, the islands, and then here in the United States, every time he gets in the ring, he knows.
Quick to take advantage of that situation as well, and so Harley Race emerges victorious in this World Championship title defense against Jumbo Tsuruta in Tokyo, Japan. We hope that you enjoyed our brief tour overseas. Talking about people who electrify other people, however, this man, the Boogie Woogie Man, Jimmy Valiant, is something else again.
Well, he is, and right now we're going to get a chance to see him again. People here in the studio audience really reacted well to him. And in the arenas all around the country where I've been personally and watched Jimmy the Boogie Woogie Man Valiant, the effect has been the same. Very electrifying. He's just an unusual performer, an unusual wrestler. Crazy, but crazy nice. And the kind of guy that when you watch him, you just can't help. It's kind of infectious. You can't help but be excited along with him.
Whether it's wrestling, singing, dancing, you name it, this man does it, and he does it with a great deal of intensity. Let's watch him.
You are too calm and see.
awesome tag team combination I have ever seen. Brother. Caught Tony Davis coming off the ropes, and how long this team will last. Pat Roode is a good, solid competitor, but he is giving away height, weight, and size.
Excuse me, Gordon, we're talking about how big the Road Warriors are, and I had many times commented that it's difficult to find anybody that would be as big as the Road Warriors. But I think today we may have found somebody who is not only as big, but might just be a little bit heavier.
I would be curious to know.
Well, I think you might know him very, very well. Without mentioning a name, does the American Dream mean anything to you?
Well, I'm sure it does
to everybody, and I'm certain that the American Dream has been watching these guys very, very closely. And when the Road Warriors put out those challenges, I think that I know Dustin Rhodes well enough to know that he's not going to turn his back. He's going to be right there accepting every challenge. And another thing that I might find, I think, very interesting is if the chance were given to Dusty, I'd sure like to see what might happen to Mr. Bundy's $15,000. That would be quite a challenge.
And knowing Dusty, catches Pat Rose coming in, and Rose catches another flat of the foot on the back. Dusty doesn't go out of his way looking for trouble, but I'll guarantee you one thing, he'll never back away from it. And I think Mr. Bundy's $15,000 is not too safe.
Well, I think there's a couple of things that are in jeopardy right now. Possibly the National Tag Team Championship belts, $15,000. But right now we're looking at the Road Warriors, and they're as awesome as ever. Big, strong, getting better and better at their ability to wrestle, tagging. They don't stay in there too long at any one time. They're always moving, and they're just awesome.
Catching him with a knee once again. Pat Rose in a lot of trouble here. And that's dangerously close to a choke on that particular rear chin lock. He was under the chin. However, he broke it early enough as they made the tag. And again, it is Rose taking the full brunt of about 280 pounds. I would imagine their combined weight has to be about 560.
Well, there's no question about it, Gordon. 560, 70, or 80, somewhere in that neighborhood. We're talking about an awful lot of weight. And if you can get in on one person, there's just hardly any way that a man can come out of it. But if you notice, when the referee starts to count, one of those Road Warriors gets out before the count of five. And everything that you're doing, whether you like it or not, and I don't like it, it's still legal. It's still technically allowable. And the referee has no choice but to just watch this punishment that's being taken by their opponents in the ring.
No question about that. He does call for the break on this one. And again, as Ole just pointed out, they do break. They make the tag, and out by the count of two on that one, Pat Rose. And he tags up with Tony Davis, and brother, the Road Warrior on him before he could even get in the ring. Down on the point of that shoulder. And this man is not going to be moving around too well tomorrow, I don't believe.
Richard Gordon's got him set up for that guillotine.
Lariat has him down. It's over. It's over. The National Tag Team Champions, the Road Warriors, are the victors in this match. A 10-minute time limit now. Les Thornton, the man of 1,001 holes, going up against Chief Joe Lightfoot. And this should promise to be an extremely fast-moving, extremely scientific match. Nice to have Charles Smithgall of WCNN Radio here with us today, along with his son, Chaz, 2-year-old Chaz, who's quite a wrestling fan already. WCNN Radio, of course, is carrying the Braves games this year. Lightfoot with a takedown on Thornton. You talk about two men who are exponents of scientists. A beautiful wrist strike. drag that time. And again, notice the way Lightfoot bridges back, does a high neck bridge back, takes the wrist with him, and as he does, of course, Thornton's got to go. Both men bullying each other about now, testing each other out for weight, balance. Good fireman carry by Thornton, but Lightfoot controlling the wrist. Pure wrestling at its very finest in these two men in the ring. Overhook the head. See if either man is able to gain some advantage here now. Thornton. Gets a snapmare, but it is the way in which Lightfoot is controlling that wrist. Thornton realizes he's got to go with it or he's going to suffer a broken wrist. All right, Lightfoot keeps the pressure on. Thornton trying to move, trying to get to the side of his man. Now then, good move. Countered it nicely, snapped there, and it up high. Lightfoot with a takedown once again. And an excellent round of applause here for the folks at the TBS Sports Arena. All right, Lightfoot pressing an advantage position here now, but it is Thornton turning to his man. He's caught in a cravat. Counter now by Thornton. Going to see a lot of this during this match. Point and counterpoint by both of these men, and it's Thornton. Looked like he was going for a full slam, did not. Got the suplex instead, but it was Lightfoot keeping Nelson on the head, now cravats it once again. So, Lightfoot has become the headhunter in this match. Thornton has diversified his attack. But again, from the suplex into keeps that the head in prison. So Thornton has been countering well, but has not been able to counter enough to take the offensive. Good bridge. Excellent bridge. Modified fireman carry takedown, but Lightfoot back up very quickly into a good snapmare. We are seeing here just great, great competition between these two men and staying well within the parameters of the rules.
Well, as somebody mentioned here not long ago, we had these two gentlemen on a match that ended up in a time limit draw. And both of them asked for and, as you can see, received a rematch. It's quite common, I would say, for a wrestler of the caliber of these two men to want to be able to solve the situation that exists between the two. They're both on good terms. You're looking at what I consider to be probably one of the great scientific matches that we've seen in a long while. And yet, it's just the natural thing to want to know which one is best.
No question about it. And we saw a good Cornish hype a moment ago by Thornton. And the British have a way of doing that. They'll get deep underneath you. And you'll come up high off the hip or sometimes even as high as the rib cage on the hype itself. It is referee Nick Patrick checking those shoulders carefully. Lightfoot putting a little more pressure on, but Thornton has that shoulder off. And Thornton, I am sure, is now trying to figure his strategy several moves ahead of the game. Now he goes to the cravat. And so it looks now that Lightfoot, who had been the headhunter earlier, now is finding himself on the receiving end of two polo-like forearms. The third forearm that puts him down. So it is Thornton who's become the headhunter now.
Well, it just reminds me, Freddie Miller just made a comment to me. He said, well, you'll find out who the best man was today. And that's a fair assessment because on any given day, as we've mentioned so many different times, I think that any one of these men is capable of being a winner over another man, depending upon the schedule, previous schedule, depending upon the matches, depending upon the traveling. There's just so many ifs in wrestling, as there are in everything. We see a great football team get defeated by a team that we just don't think has a ghost of a chance. It happens all the time in sports. The mental attitude is so
important. Buccaneers in your eyes when you say that.
Well, there was a story about why the Buccaneers are 0-8.
Oh, really? What's that?
I understand they haven't
played nine games yet.
Oh, boy. Okay, it is Les Norton in trouble again, and it is Lightfoot. Lightfoot with that cravat, punishing him now into a snapmare once again and takes him back to the canvas. Boy, these two are great competitors and great conditioners.
Well, they sure are. You know, people wonder what it would be like to be a wrestler. All you've got to do is watch these two guys. Of course, watch all the matches. But here you see an example of scientific wrestling, good, clean wrestling. Exciting. Almost.
Bridge by Lightfoot brought himself back up, and might have the advantage here on a backslide. Let's see if he gets him. No, sir. Rolls away from it again. Tomahawk chop coming off. Good thinking there.
Boy, they're really after it. They're both trying to beat each other, using a system of moves. Again, all scientific, all within the rules. Just back and forth, back and forth.
Gut wrench salto, got started to go for it again. Got the count. Got the count. And I don't believe Lightfoot thought his shoulders were down. Lightfoot may have relaxed.
That is for one fall with a 10-minute time limit. In the red corner at 250 pounds from the Far East, Kendo Nagasaki, the Black Ninja. And in the blue corner at 237 pounds from Virginia Beach, Virginia, Magnum T.A.
Action continues now as the Oriental star, Kendo Nagasaki, the Black Ninja. Waited not. Ted DiBiase going against Magnum T.A. Terry Allen, a half-line dropkick. Terry Allen takes the stick and really working over the Black Ninja. And he'll be sorry this day that he brought it to the ring and scrambling out in a hurry. Kendo Nagasaki, as Terry Allen, who captivated the fans last week here on Mid-South in his first appearance with his sensational maneuvers, now waiting for the Black Ninja to come back, and in he is with an arm drag and down.
Boy, Terry, I've heard an awful lot about this young man, Terry Allen. They call him Magnum T.A. with some reference to the fact that he looks like a movie star. Well, I tell you what, if he wants to survive in Mid-South, he's better get the movie star idea out of his head, because the only stars he's going to see around here are the ones that are made by a big paw upside your head or a boot to your head. He underestimated Kendo Nagasaki a little bit already. Nagasaki taking the fight back to him. The worst thing that a wrestler can do is become overconfident. I'll have to say, in watching him, though, Boyd Pierce, boy is game.
He says, come on and get it, the Black Ninja, and carrying the attack, the Magnum T.A. with the slam.
Well, he'd better take it to the Ninja, because if he lets up for an instant and shows an opening, that Ninja will be right on it. Big drop kick. Backslide, two count, not enough to keep him down.
Terry Allen now, Magnum T.A. Wait a minute, Gatsu coming to the ring on the apron. Magnum T.A. invites him on the inside and brings him in. Hey, takes on both men, Gatsu and the Ninja. From behind, Ninja, now Gatsu, spinning around, there goes the green flame, and in a nick of time, catches it full force with Gatsu.
Stomach's up.
Bodily drop, one, two, three.
All I can say is I wish my hand was well.
Ninja,
I can't wait till this hand gets well. I'll show some of these young boys.
Backfired on Gatsu, the winner, Magnum T.A.
And my thanks to Boyd Pierce and the Cowboy Bill Watts in Mid-South for giving us an opportunity to see Magnum T.A. in action.
Right here. You know, everywhere we go, they're always trying to find someone to stop us. Everywhere. Nobody stops us. This train don't stop. And that train don't stop. What do you think about that, brother? We don't care who it is. There's nobody that comes even close to beating the Road Warriors.
Interesting comments from the National Tag Team Champions, Jake the Snake Roberts, and his new manager, Precious Paul Ellering.
You know, the most amazing thing, Gordon, that's happening in the worldwide area right now is that I have been here for nearly a month, and there are no titles around my waist. For one reason and one reason only. Because I cannot deal with politics. Because being a child of society, a product of society, I don't know how to deal with the people. But this man does. And he's given me some things. He's given me some contracts that have been signed and sealed, so there's no way out. So there's going to be some champions around here that are going to be met with the sad realization that the snake is here, and he's here to stay, and Paul Ellering will be by his side from now on.
You know, Jake, I understand what a demented society can do to an individual. So therefore, I can understand where there can be a failure to communicate, and that is where I can help you, because contracts are my business, and more than what you know is what I know.
Surrounded by a sea of controversy, but more recently it appears that, well, some strange events are occurring.
There's been a lot of strange things going on. You know, the Mad Dog, there's only one Mad Dog. You got the Dusty Rhodes, there's only one Dusty Rhodes. You got the Wildfires, there's only one Wildfire. So I can understand where they're coming from. But you know, you people right now are looking at the best the World Championship has to offer. When I say that, I mean the best in the world today. You got the Dusty Rhodes, the Tommy Riches, the Pistol Pez Whatley's, the number twos. You got the Snake coming up in the world. You got everything going on. You got Paul Ellering. A lot of things going on. You know, my life is full of mysteries.
Do I denote a little bit of tension here?
A little bit of tension. A lot of you people out there know what I'm talking about. What I'm talking about is Buzz Sawyer being the greatest in the world. What I'm talking about is what I've always been.
Here's the commercial.
Thanks for watching the best of championship wrestling. The announcers on this program are employed by Georgia Championship Wrestling Incorporated.
Thank you very much and welcome again to World Championship Wrestling. And as we promised you last week, we do have the National Heavyweight Championship upcoming. One fall with a one-hour time limit. We do have standby matches in the event that the match does not go the entire hour, although frankly, I can't help but feel that it's going to go an hour. I just have that deep down feeling. Let me bring in Ole Anderson, see if I can't get his opinion on this. Brett Wayne defending his national title against the challenge of Jake the Snake Roberts. One fall with a one-hour time limit, and I have a hunch it may go the distance.
Gordon, I don't know. We're looking at two very talented wrestlers. We're looking at a gutsy young kid, and we're looking at a guy that's got a few more years of experience. Without a question, it's going to be a very interesting match.
No question about that, and it has additional interest, too. From the standpoint, Ole flew down to the Tampa Bay area this past week, and he and I took a little trip that I found very revealing and very interesting.
Well, we went to a hospital and we visited a woman by the name of Mrs. Woyan, who, of course, like many millions of people all around the country, is very, very interested in what's happening here on television. And she has two sons of her own. And she told us that her older son left home when he was 16 years old and has kind of become the black sheep of the family a little bit. And for that reason, the other son, who she's very proud of, loves them both, and I think she said, has changed his name, and he now wrestles under the name of Brett Wayne. He's our national champion, the man we're going to be seeing in the ring.
Exactly, and it was a very, very interesting situation, a very revealing time with Mrs. Wayne. She's a lovely lady, and we certainly wish her the very, very best and a very, very speedy recovery. But, well, I think most importantly right now is the fact that Brett's putting it all on the line here today.
Well, he is, and of course, we're all going to be pulling for Brett Wayne. We hope that things go his way. And to his mother, Mrs. Woyan, out there, the best to you. I understand that she's going to be released, possibly. She may have been released yesterday, or she may be released, in fact, today. She's hoping to be in out in time to even attend the matches. We want to wish her the best. We want to wish her son the best. And I think our ring announcer's in the ring. Maybe we can get to that introduction.
Let's go now to our ring announcer, Ron Haley.
Ladies and gentlemen, World Championship Wrestling presents for the National Heavyweight Championship, one fall with a 60-minute time limit. Introducing first, ladies and gentlemen, on my right, from Shreveport, Louisiana, 242 pounds, managed by Precious Paul Ellering, Snake the Jake Roberts! Jake the Snake Roberts! On my right, ladies and gentlemen, the National Heavyweight Champion at 226 pounds from St. Petersburg, Florida, Brett Wayne! Brett Wayne!
Okay, you've been instructed on the rules. I'd like to remind you, if you're in the ropes, you have a 5 count to get off the ropes. 5 counts is a disqualification. If you're out on the floor, you have a 10 count to make it back inside the ring. If you're in the ropes, it's a 5 count. If you're outside, if you're down on the mat, it's a 10 count, okay? Are there any questions about the rules?
I don't have any questions.
Any questions, Brett?
No, sir.
Okay, I'd like to wish both men good luck. Jake, here's the belt.
I see it.
Okay, each man to his corner.
I want you to... We'll be back. We'll be back with this match right after we pause for these commercial words. There's the bell. This is the beginning of this match. One fall with a one-hour time limit. We do have standby matches if necessary. Brett Wayne in the red trunks, the National Heavyweight Champion at 226 pounds out of St. Petersburg, Florida, going up against Jake the Snake Roberts, 242 pounds out of Shreveport, Louisiana. They lock up his collar and elbow, and it's Jake the Snake bullying Brett Wayne back to the turnbuckle. Paul Ellering watching very carefully. An extremely important match for both men. Obviously, Brett Wayne putting it all on the line. Beautiful drop kick by Wayne. The first one to score a takedown is Brett Wayne, and Wayne looking confident, but I must say I'm sure he's got some butterflies.
Well, I think we all got some butterflies, and certainly Brett Wayne does, and I think that Jake the Snake has got some. Ellering's exhibiting a little bit of anxiety, too. You know, one thing that I think was really good, and that is that last week we didn't allow Brett Wayne to get on television and wrestle because I think the rest has done him a lot of good. He's had a couple of matches during the week, of course, but... You know, just getting that one day or two, that makes a heck of a lot of difference. And as his mother said when we visited her, she was so wonderful in her praise to say, oh, thank you, thank you. But, you know, we realized that it was so important to let Brett have a little bit of rest. So now I think we can see him. He's almost at 100%. And in any event, as she said, he's the kind of kid that you just can't hold down. And we know that better than anybody, probably.
No question about that. Brett Wayne now with a side headlock on Jake the Snake Roberts. Roberts up to one knee. All right, Roberts all the way up. Roberts holds a height advantage here. But, brother, I'll tell you what. Brett Wayne was right on top of him again. A good shoulder smash coming off the rope. Drives the knee into the chest of Jake the Snake Roberts. And if there was any worry about that left leg of Brett Wayne, it appears to be pretty much 100%.
Well, it looks like it's doing real well. And, of course, I tell you one thing that's going to be a tremendous boost for Brett Wayne. All you have to do is listen to these people, listen to their enthusiasm and how they're cheering Brett Wayne. That can make you feel 100% even if you're a little bit down.
No question about that. Referee Nick Patrick is the official, and it is Jake the Snake Roberts moving back into the ring, having received some last-minute comments from Precious Paul Ellering. Jake the Snake tried for an ankle sweep, and it was Brett Wayne in a good back out. Interestingly enough, both of these men realizing that it's a one-fall, one-hour time limit, in one sense of the word, that takes a little bit of pressure off because you have a longer time limit so that their strategy can be a little bit more cautious.
Well, you're right, Gordon. You know, we had to get some special permission from the NWA, and Bob Geigel, the president, gave his okay to it. The board of directors, after deciding, thought that 1 hour on television would be fine. We do have some complications with that, and I think we might tell the people that in the event we have to go to a commercial break, and we've got several, that we will make sure that they won't miss anything. Taping will continue, and in the event there is a pinfall or a submission during that commercial break, we will be showing it in its entirety after that break.
No question about that. And it is Brett Wayne keeping the side headlock now on Jake the Snake Roberts. Fitzpatrick checking very carefully, watching those shoulders. Roberts hooking the leg and trying to bring him around into a pinning combination. By Brett Wayne keeping the side headlock. And it is Brett Wayne with the... good move by Roberts, and it's interesting trying to figure each man's strategy in this particular match. Brett Wayne, the champion, has been carrying the fight to Jake the Snake Roberts, and yet he is exhibiting a reasonable amount of caution, I think.
Well, at 235 or 240 pounds, he's a smaller man, and of course he has to be aggressive, I think, to keep Jake the Snake off guard.
Roberts now trying to turn it to his own advantage. Referee Nick Roberts watching very carefully. There you see Precious Paul. A lot of pressure on Precious Paul at this particular moment, too, because he's the one who brought this match to fruition. And obviously, it could make a great deal of difference to Jake the Snake Roberts in personal income. And, of course, that again affects Precious Paul.
It sure does. And Precious Paul's made quite a few statements, bold that they were. And he's produced. He's managed to get two championship matches, one for the national heavyweight that we're looking here at here, and another one involving the world television title match. And if Jake the Snake doesn't come through after being coached by Mr. Ellering, I think it'll not only hurt Jake the Snake's career, but it's going to also cause a few problems for Paul Ellering, because they may question his ability to manage.
Excellent point, and you can see Ellering again. Jake the Snake lashes out, catches Brett Wayne in the side of the ribcage, then catches him with a forearm across the back. Brett Wayne fires back to the midsection again, and again to the midsection of Jake the Snake Roberts. Roberts equal to the occasion, however. Good reversal by Brett Wayne. Wayne has him a good full body slam. Roberts.
We see it over and over again. That's Brett Wayne, you just can't hold him down. You listen to these people, how excited they are. They know that behind Brett Wayne, there's a lot of heart, there's a lot of guts, and they're just helping him out, and he's wrestling. Sometimes he wrestles beyond the capability that he naturally possesses. To me, it's an amazing thing.
Well, when that adrenaline gets flowing, and the ego, and I mean ego in the proper sense, when that self-esteem begins to rise up inside of you, and you realize that there are literally millions of people banking on you and counting on you, as they are for Brett Wayne, no question about that. He's clearly the favorite here as far as the fans are concerned. That has to have a lot to do with it. That has to give you that extra desire, that extra push. Jake the Snake Roberts is doing everything that he can, and I must say this, that Roberts has stayed well within the confines of the rules and regulations thus far.
Well, I think everybody is getting the message. I think they understand that World Championship Wrestling and Georgia Championship Wrestling, that we mean business, and that we're not going to take infractions of the rules lightly. But we realize that there are a lot of things that are going to happen. They just have to. If you want to have a football game, you've got to have maybe a couple of late hits. You've got to expect that, because people get so caught up in the enthusiasm of the moment emotionally that things do happen. That part we understand. It's the premeditated or the blatant disregard for rules that we're trying to avoid or discourage. And Ellering is certainly well aware of that. DiBiase was a good example of a person who found out that he just couldn't get away with anything. And I think for that reason, we're seeing a pretty scientific match right now.
Absolutely. Jake the Snake Roberts doesn't want to run that risk of being disqualified. And so it is a good move by Brett Wayne as Roberts scored the takedown. But Brett Wayne hung in and maintained his hold. For those of you who may have tuned in late, let me remind you once again, you're watching a national heavyweight championship match. One fall, a one-hour time limit.
Brett Wayne in the red trunks, the national heavyweight champion, defending his title against the challenge of Jake the Snake Roberts, managed by Precious Paul Ellering. Referee in this match is Nick Patrick. It is for the national heavyweight championship. Wayne at 226 pounds out of St. Petersburg, Florida. And I know, having visited with her this past week, along with Ole Anderson, that Mrs. Wyan, his mother, has got to be watching this with a great deal of interest. She is exceptionally proud of Brett. And as Ole mentioned, of course, they have two sons, one of whom left home at the age of 16 and became rather the black sheep of the family, I suppose, if that's a proper terminology. Brett, however, certainly brought tremendous pride to the Wyan family. There you see Precious Paul watching and obviously very concerned about this match and the potential outcome. Wayne shaking his head, trying to get rid of those cobwebs as he's caught again by another forearm by Jake the Snake Roberts. Jake the Snake Roberts lashes out, and Buzz Sawyer, another of Precious Paul's entourage or stable, if you will, watching this match. He, too, is obviously extremely interested. Wayne off the rope, caught again by Jake the Snake Roberts and Precious Paul Ellering, urging Roberts on. And Buzz Sawyer watching with a great deal of interest.
You know, I know how concerned everyone is, and we are, too. But I'll tell you, Mrs. Wayan, I think your boy is okay. He shows more courage and more determination than I've seen in a lot of years in the sporting world. And I think that, I think the kid is just great.
No question about it. Brett Wayne explodes that time on Jake the Snake Roberts. Roberts fires back, however. Brother, you talk about intensity. The level of intensity here is extremely high. And Buzz Sawyer even getting caught up in the spirit of this match. And well, he is obviously watching as Jake the Snake Roberts. Roberts. Tending to dominate the situation, and the referee warning Jake the Snake about that particular tactic. And Jake the Snake moving in on Brett Wayne once again. Brett Wayne powers out before the count. Jake the Snake back on his feet. Jake the Snake lashes out, and it looks to me only like Jake the Snake is beginning to turn the tide of this match.
Well, I'll tell you, Jake is a good wrestler. There's no question about that. And he's got one added advantage, and that is that he's not afraid to... He's not breaking the rules, but he's bending them a little bit, and he's decided that the sportsmanlike way maybe isn't the way for him.
Interesting point. He's got, I would think he's got two advantages going for him. He's got Precious Paul Ellering as his manager. He is a stablemate of Buzz Sawyer's, and Brett Wayne has got his problems with Jake the Snake using that headbutt very effectively into the ribcage.
Well, as you know, in football, something like that would be called a spear, and it would be illegal, and there would be a penalty, 15 yards. If there were continued use of that, the man would undoubtedly be taken out of the game. It just so happens that in wrestling, we not only don't have any protection to defend against that, but there's nothing in the rules that prohibit somebody from using that move.
Precisely, and now it is the wow! End, and his Wayne is down, and this may be it. This may be all she wrote. We may have a new national heavyweight. No, sir. No, sir. Brett Wayne powered out at the very last second. But boy, you talk about giving a great effort, but Jake the Snake Roberts definitely has things going his way. Jake the Snake now drives a knee into the side of the rib cage. And Brett Wayne has to be having a lot of problems now in trying to get his breath. He's into the ropes.
Brett Wayne, a bit desperate at this point in time. No question about it, James Snake Roberts turned the tide in this match and is very definitely has things going his way.
He tried a cheap shot there. He came in, and I think he was aiming for that leg. I'm not quite certain. Roberts, with all the punishment that he's dishing out, Wayne keeps on coming back and to go for what I consider to be a definite cheap shot.
Paul Ellering just shoved Brett Wayne back into the ring, and Sawyer took a bit of umbrage to that. Down for the belter. He powered out again. Powered out again. Tremendous second effort on the part of Brett Wayne. And it is the precious Paul Ellering cheering Jake the Snake Robert Clown. And Buzz Sawyer. Wait a minute. Brett Wayne fired back. He's got Roberts in trouble now. Brett Wayne caught again by Jake the Snake Roberts. Good reversal by Brett Wayne. Wayne closes in. He opens up with a series of right hands and pressures Paul Ellering. Dismayed at this turn of events. Brett Wayne catches him coming off the rope. It's Brett Wayne moving in for a lateral press and a pin, but Jake the Snake Roberts powers out. Paul Ellering continues to issue all kinds of advice. Ooh. A reverse atomic knee drop that has Brett Wayne in a lot of trouble now. And Paul Ellering continues to shout encouragement to Jake the Snake Roberts.
I tell you, a move like that will just jar that spinal column and really does things to your back and goes right up to your neck. It's almost like being hit over the head because that jar is so tremendous with all of your weight coming down like that. Brett's in trouble.
He is in trouble indeed, and precious Paul Ellering and Buzz Sawyer right there at ringside, and it's Jake the Snake Roberts continuing to punish Brett Wayne. Wayne hanging on in the corner. Jake the Snake closes in. And, wait a second, Ellering just caught him with a cheap shot. And Buzz Sawyer just threw Ellering to one side.
Referee's just out of control. That Jake the Snake has gone a little bit. Not, stop Buzz Sawyer.
Buzz Sawyer just charged the ring. Buzz Sawyer just charged the ring. And now it's Jake the Snake, Robert Beckham, and Buzz Sawyer. Bradbury is Buzz Sawyer raising some kind of havoc in that ring now. Buzz Sawyer could take it no longer. And Brett Wayne and Buzz Sawyer. And it is, obviously this match has come to a close. This match has come to a close, and Buzz Sawyer in a stunning turn of events. And now, here's a commercial word.
Tonight, 8:30, the Omni in Atlanta. NWA World Heavyweight Championship. Harley Race, 7 times world champion, clashes with a former champion himself, Wildfire Tommy Rich, with special referee Pistol Pez Watley. National Tag Team Championship. The Road Warriors champions against the American Dream, the Tower of Power, Dusty Rhodes, and his partner, National Heavyweight Champion Brett Wayne. The Mad Dog Buzz Sawyer clashes with the Incredible Man from Sudan, Abdullah the Butcher, plus the Great Kabuki against Boogie Woogie Man Jimmy Valiant. Jake the Snake Roberts goes after Ron Garvin's TV title, plus 2 other matches. That's tomorrow night, 8:30, the Omni. Be there.
We're going to be seeing King Kong Bundy in action. Here's a man who's got $15,000 up to anybody who can body slam him. And, of course, so far, nobody's been able to do that. He's a 450-pound monster is about the only thing I can say about King Kong Bundy. And we will be seeing him in action. Certainly want to welcome a lot of folks here today from all over the country, including James Dawson from Fife, Alabama, and a host of others. Right now, though, let's go to this match of King Kong Bundy. See him, King Kong Bundy, moving out against Frank Levert. And I've watched this man, Levert tried to slam, and with Bundy, he's got $1,000 up for anybody who can do it.
He does, Gordon. Bundy has made the challenge right now. Anybody that can slam him, pick him up off his feet, get him in the air, and slam him to the mat is going to be the winner of $1,000. So, of course, there's a lot of people that are going to go for it, and this young man in the ring right now is hoping he'll be $1,000 richer.
Meantime, Bundy's going to get about $1,000 worth of his skin if he can. Bundy at 420 pounds and a massive individual.
Look at that kid that Bundy's wrestling. He's a big kid also. The one thing that really amazes me about Bundy, you see a lot of big, well, I shouldn't say see a lot, but you see occasionally a big man. But you don't see anybody that's got the same size as Bundy. I guess there isn't. You don't see a lot of big people that have that same ferocity. Is that it? Ferocity? What's
ferocity,
the word?
Ferocity,
all right.
Yeah.
That guy really is like an animal. He is just coming all the time. He's just on top of his opponent, and he's brutal.
He's interestingly proportioned, too. He has massive legs, and obviously that upper body, he certainly gives that, wow, forearm into Leverett, and now Leverett, well, just in all kinds of trouble, and as Foley pointed out, Leverett has to go close to 300 pounds himself, but Bundy is just completely demolishing his man. Bundy insists upon that five count, and he wants to make sure that nobody ever misunderstands whether or not he's won the match. Crashing down on Leverett now. Timekeeper ringing the bell at the count of three, but Bundy insisted upon the count of five. So there's your victor, King Kong Bundy. Since the time of that particular match, however, Bundy has raised the ante to $15,000 for anybody who can body slam him. Precious Paul Ellering has joined me.
Well, Sawyer, you've let sentimentality cloud your mind, but that's no matter, because I was going to get rid of you anyway. You see, you start to embarrass me. I got a new champion, Abdullah the Butcher, and with Jake the Snake. Everybody, including you, Tommy Rich, Pez Watley, Ronnie Garvin, and you, Big Mouth Ole Anderson, you're all going to feel the wrath of Precious Paul, and especially you, Buzz Sawyer. Time is a precious commodity, and it's not something that you have too much of.
Well, I find that most interesting that Abdullah the Butcher now in the camp of Precious Paul Ellering.
You know something, Sawyer, I don't know how many times it's going to happen that I go out into that ring and something comes up to save somebody, whether it's Ronnie Garvin, whether it's Brett Wayne, whether it's Ole Anderson, or you, Buzz Sawyer. Is somebody going to keep popping up at the wrong time just to follow what I'm doing? I don't think so, because I'll tell you something. I've got two title matches. That was one of them. I got another one coming. And you remember this. Ever since the beginning of the time, when the Snake first came up the tree, yeah, the good old apple tree, they said he couldn't do it, but it was done.
Here's a commercial word. And Ole Anderson and I were just discussing, of course,
Buzz, I know you mean well, and I know you care. Just come on home. You know, stay away from Precious Paul Ellering. I know you mean well, and I know you're trying to do good. I know you're just trying to help me. Just come on home, Buzz.
Very, very touching moment with young Brett Wayne.
I think that there's something maybe now that the people should know. It's something that we found out when we talked to Mrs. Wayne, who happens to be the mother of Brett Wayne. I'm sure that there are people that know about it. I've known about it for some time, as you have. The other son, the son that she was talking about that we mentioned that had left home when he was 16 years old, wrestled under another name, is Buzz Sawyer. And I think certainly if there was ever a time for a guy to make a change in his life, this certainly would be it.
Family. Les Thornton getting set to move out against Pat Rose. One fall with a 10-minute time limit. And Pat Rose, extremely competent competitor, but going up against the man with 1,001 holds, Thornton, who does wrestle in the classic European style. And there's a beautiful example of what I'm talking about, a high Cornish hype that took Rose to the canvas. Rose very quickly trying to turn that into a pinning combination. I just wonder if we are going to see a change now in Buzz Sawyer.
Gordon, you know, I don't want to take away from the match or anything like that, but I can't get my mind off it. I've mentioned over the weeks, and I think we've all seen how Buzz Sawyer finds himself in a situation where he's watching every time Brett Wayne wrestles. As I say, I've known that they were brothers, and there are several people that have known it. They've been together off and on over the past whole year, I guess. And Brett has tried, he's told me on many occasions, he's tried to get Buzz to see the error of his ways, to get away from Ellering and people like Snake. And certainly, who knows better than that type of thing than me? I guess when you're trying as hard as you can to win, you sometimes forget the right and the wrong. All you want to do is win, and all you want to do is make money. I was like that for many, many years, and I know Buzz is the same type of thing. I've always been high on him. I've always felt that there was something deep down in Buzz Sawyer, and today I really see it. And although we made a promise to the mother, Mrs. Wyan, I hope that you forgive us, since Fred has made mention of the fact I was no longer in trying to keep it a secret. I think certainly that this is the time. You know, you just have turning points in your life, crossroads, so to speak. And this is the time, and I think, again, like to say, sometimes you only have one chance. I think this is the time for Buzz Sawyer to take that opportunity, and I couldn't have said it better, and I'm sure Mrs. Warren would say the same thing. I think it's time for Buzz Sawyer to come home.
Well put. Well put phraseology by Ole Anderson, and who really would be more qualified to perhaps understand the feelings of Buzz Sawyer than Ole Anderson, because here's a man who did in his entire wrestling career really feel that winning was the thing at any cost. And, well, maybe we'll get a chance to talk to Buzz Sawyer later on in the program. I certainly hope so. I'd like to find out exactly at what point did he realize that family was certainly much more important than the green. So beautiful takedown by Thornton once again. And Nick Patrick down there watching those shoulders very carefully. Nick Patrick, one of the finest officials in the NWA, does an outstanding job. Thornton using that forearm. Marshall Nelson on that rose, and he's into the ropes. The referee calls for the break. And Thornton steps back. Thornton, of course, will sell the World Junior Heavyweight Championship. A double-double. Painted to the shoulder, drop down, a single ankle pickup. And again, demonstrating that great versatility that he does have. Thornton moves inside his man, brings him up. Back into a souffle, and Rose powered out, and that surprises me. Atomic knee drop from a side salto, and there's the pinfall. He's got the pinfall, no question about that. Well, I might just say that hopefully we'll get a chance to talk to Buzz a little bit later.
I'm going to go look for him. I think right now, though, we've got some words previously recorded, a commercial message from Brett Wayne and Dusty Rhodes.
The American Dream is up. Is a champion of champions, seven times NWA World Heavyweight Champion.
Well, it just goes to show what a person can do if he puts his mind to it. Certainly, Harley's the type of guy that doesn't know the meaning of the word quit, stop, and he's been a good champion. He's been a tough champion, but it also means having won it seven times means that he's lost it a few times. It means that at any given point, he could lose it again.
No question about it, and of course, the champion is always the target. Every competitor wants to be the very best in his field, and Harley Race at the moment is the man to beat. Let's go to this videotape match.
This match is for one fall with a 10-minute time limit. Introducing on my right from Phoenix, weighing 232 pounds, Reggie Parks. His opponent on my left from Kansas City, weighing 248 pounds, the world heavyweight champion, Harley Race.
And there you can see the $10,000 gold and diamond studded belt. Solid gold with diamond studs in it. This, of course, represents the NWA World Heavyweight Championship, and that's the oldest and the largest sanctioning body of professional wrestling the world over. And it covers most of the United States, Canada, Mexico, Hawaii, Australia, Japan, Singapore, and it goes on and on and on. Race with a side headlock on Reggie Parks. Now, Race going after Parks is not going after a stranger to the ring warm. Race, my, caught in a backdrop. Parks. Race powers out, but he's suffering from that backdrop.
Reggie Parks, front face lock now on Harley Race, the world heavyweight champion. One has to admire the champion for coming on television. He has everything to lose. Reggie Parks obviously has everything to gain. He can defeat the champion or hold him to a draw. It would catapult him into a number one contention for that world title. On the break, it was Race catching him in the pit of the stomach. Reggie Parks. Back in the turnbuckle now. Race in the blue trunks. Parks in the black trunks. Reversal by Parks as Race fires another backdrop after being whipped into the far turnbuckle. Race again powers him off. Race caught him, a headbutt to the midsection. Again, a snapmare that takes Harley Race to the canvas. Reggie Parks, rather, I'm sorry. Harley Race drives the knee in. Parks. Come against those turnbuckles. Race. Dominating the situation right now. Tried to bring Parks up, but Parks tripped him up to an inside cradle. And Race has to be frustrated over this now. And Race. Don't be fooled by Harley Race. This man, extremely clever in the ring, a master at human chess. Parks again with a side headlock on the world heavyweight champion. Race won the title first in 1973, lost it the same year, then regained it February of 1977 when he defeated Terry Funk in Toronto, Canada. He has held onto the title ever since. Began wrestling at the age of 17. After his first year of active competition, he was injured. Modified pile driver. No, sir. Parks powers out. Race was severely injured in an automobile accident. The doctors told him at that time he probably would never walk again, but that he was done as an athlete. And today you see him, the pinnacle of success, the world heavyweight wrestling champion. Race travels in excess of a quarter of a million miles a year defending his title throughout the United States, Australia, Canada, Japan, Mexico, you name it, he's been there. Race catching Parks, and it's Parks reversing the situation. Race went for a salto, and Parks reversed it on him. And we could very easily have an upset in the making here. Reggie Parks comes off the rope, catches Race, a beautiful flying dropkick, and Reggie Parks is closing in on the champion. Race powers out again, but Reggie Parks, now with renewed vigor, moves against him again. Race caught in the backdrop. Parks been using that very effectively. Parks went up for a flying dropkick. Race stepped back. Out of the way. Parks came down. Head to jar. That spinal column. Race catches him a full body stance. Race moving up on that second rope. Parks stunned. Race dives headlong. Catches him. For Reggie Parks.
Of course, has the great Kabuki under his management, and the great Kabuki, of course, carrying on the tradition of his family and a lineage that spans centuries in actuality. Let's join this match in progress as we watch the great Kabuki in action. Kabuki stalking his man, closes in on him once again. They lock up collar and elbow. Kabuki slides through into a side headlock. Referee Tommy Young watching carefully, making sure that there is no choke involved in this. Young, by the way, an outstanding official. Had the pleasure of working with Tommy on many occasions in the past.
Kabuki lashes out, catches him twice now with hard forearms, and then drives back again. And as he does, fearing retaliation, there you see a savate-type blow into the midsection and then a chop to the back of the head. And so it is Kabuki punishing his man. And he is a man, much like Abdullah the Butcher, who appears to be impervious to pain. And the harder you get to him, the faster and stronger he seems to come back. You could hear that chop all the way across the building as Kabuki catches him and punishes him some more. Kabuki is not only a fearless competitor, but a relentless competitor. Kabuki keeping the pressure on both sides. There you see that evil genius, Gary Hart, watching carefully from ringside. Gary Hart, of course, known as Playboy Gary Hart, from an extremely wealthy background. I'm a young down, 2 pound. Again, that's Savat to the midsection. Kabuki, his opponent, somewhat dazed, somewhat helpless. Kabuki off the top rope, catches him, a chop into the top of the head. And again, Kabuki closes in. She has an interesting mixture of ways to go after his opponent. From the Oriental type chops to American catch-as-catch-can wrestling to the French or Korean style of foot boxing, he combines them all and combines them extremely well. Kabuki in trouble here momentarily. Let's see what happens. But Kabuki able to power out before the count. High backdrop may have Kabuki in trouble at this point. Good reversal by Kabuki. Catches him with a foot coming off the rope. And that drove his man to the canvas. And he has been punished. And punished hard. And there is that specialty of Kabuki. It's all over. It's all over. That puts tremendous pressure, reverse pressure on the knee. And we'll be seeing it again in the slow motion. You'll see what I'm talking about as he overhooks with the leg. Watch him now as he, an Irish whip off the ropes. Then here comes that savat to the chest of his opponent, and from there he moves on and scores the submission hold. And that's the one thing about Kabuki. He does not like to pin his men. He likes to force them into a submission hold.
So the Road Warriors, the national tag team champions, making short work indeed of the team that they were facing. Got his problems as Jake the Snake using that headbutt very effectively into the ribcage.
Well, as you know, in football, something like that would be called a spear, and it would be illegal, and there would be a penalty. 15 yards, if there were continued use of that, the man would be undoubtedly be taken out of the game. It just so happens that in wrestling, we not only don't have any protection to defend against that, but there's nothing in the rules that prohibit somebody from using that move.
Precisely, and now it is the wow! In that his Wayne is down, and this may be it. This may be all she wrote. We may have a new national heavyweight. No, sir. No, sir. Brett Wayne powered out at the very last second. But boy, you talk about giving a great effort, but Jake the Snake Roberts definitely has things going his way. Jake the Snake now drives a knee into the side of the rib cage. And Brett Wayne has to be having a lot of problems now in trying to get his breath. No, sir. He's into the ropes. He's into the ropes. Brett Wayne a bit desperate at this point in time. No question about it. Jake the Snake Roberts turned the tide in this match. And is very definitely has things going his way.
He tried a cheap shot there. He came in, and I think he was aiming for that leg. I'm not quite certain. You know, Roberts, with all the punishment that he's dishing out, Wayne keeps on coming back. And to go for what I consider to be a definite cheap shot.
Paul Ellering just shoved Brett Wayne back into the ring, and Sawyer took a bit of umbrage to that. Down to the dumpster, he powered out again. Powered out again. Tremendous second effort on the part of Brett Wayne. And it is the precious Paul Ellering cheering Jake the Snake Roberts on. And Buzz Sawyer. Wait a minute. Brett Wayne fired back. He's got Roberts in trouble now. Brett Wayne caught again by Jake the Snake Roberts. Good reversal by Brett Wayne. Wayne closes in. He opens up with a series of right hands and precious Paul Ellering. Dismayed at this turn of events. Coming off the rope. It's Brett Wayne moving in for a lateral press and a pin, but Jake the Snake Roberts powers out. Paul Ellering continues to issue all kinds of advice. Ooh. A reverse atomic knee drop that has Brett Wayne in a lot of trouble now. And Paul Ellering continues to shout encouragement to Jake the Snake Roberts.
I tell you, a move like that will just jar that spinal column and really does things to your back and goes right up to your neck. It's almost like being hit over the head because that jar is so tremendous with all of your weight coming down like that. Brett's in trouble.
He is in trouble indeed, and precious Paul Ellering and Buzz Sawyer right there at ringside, and it's Jake the Snake Roberts continuing to punish Brett Wayne. Wayne hanging on in the corner. Jake the Snake closes in. And, wait a second, Ellering just caught him with a cheap shot. And Buzz Sawyer just threw Ellering to one side.
Referee's just out of control. That Jake the Snake has gone a little bit nuts. Stop Buzz Sawyer.
Buzz Sawyer just charged the ring. Buzz Sawyer just charged the ring. And now it's Jake the Snake Roberts after Ben Buzz Sawyer. Brother is Buzz Sawyer raising some kind of havoc in that ring now. Buzz Sawyer could take it no longer. And Brett Wayne and Buzz Sawyer. And it is, obviously this match has come to a close. This match has come to a close, and Buzz Sawyer in a stunning turn of events. And now, here's a commercial word. There will be wrestling tonight in Augusta, Georgia, tomorrow afternoon in Columbus, Georgia. On November 26th, wrestling comes to Columbus, Ohio, November 27th, Cincinnati, Ohio, and Thursday, December 1st in Wheeling, West Virginia. Tomorrow night, the Omni.
Buzz Sawyer and the Omni, you will feel the wrath of precious Paul, for it is Abdullah the Butcher that you must face, the man from Sudan backs up from no man, and I know every trick in the book, Buzz Sawyer, because I taught you very well. Buzz Sawyer, you can't run with the big dogs, you can't go on the hunt. It's all over, Buzz Sawyer.
Ronnie Garvin, your time is up. The TV title will be mine. You won't be saved.
Cruiserweight Championship. Harley Race, 7 times world champion, clashes with a former champion himself, Wildfire Tommy Rich, with special referee Pistol Pez Watley. National Tag Team Championship. The Road Warriors, champions against the American Dream, the Tower of Power, Dusty Rhodes, and his partner, National Heavyweight Champion Brett Wayne. The Mad Dog, Buzz Sawyer, clashes with the Incredible Man from Sudan, Abdullah the Butcher, plus the Great Kabuki against Boogie Woogie Man Jimmy Valiant. Jake the Snake Roberts goes after Ron Garvin's TV title, plus 2 other matches. That's tomorrow night, 8:30, the Omni. Be there.
I always had tremendous respect for you as an athlete. You were a very intense competitor. But I think you made a big, big mistake when you put all your eggs in one basket, challenging Wildfire Tommy Rich to the last match, where it was obvious that you intended to go out there and destroy him and rid him from World Championship Wrestling forever. But you came up short. And now you're trying to salvage some degree of self-respect by challenging Abdullah the Butcher. You know, Buzz, I think you've made your second mistake, because it's almost like jumping from the frying pan into the fire. Because standing behind me, just returned from a very successful tour throughout Africa, where he is the African heavyweight champion and very proudly holding the trophy. We've been all waiting for this moment when the man that made James J. Dillon in a world tour some 3 years ago, coming home to Atlanta, Georgia, coming home to World Championship Wrestling. And you, Buzz Sawyer, think because you've made a tactical mistake in your match with Tommy Rich, are going to try and steal the thunder, regain your prestige by challenging my black specimen? Buzz Sawyer, you're a bigger fool than I ever thought you were. And when Abdullah the Butcher gets a hold of you, he's going to chew you up in little tiny pieces.
Okay, those are the comments of one J.J. Dillon, man who was named Wrestling Manager of the Year last year. Bob Brown in the ring now. We're waiting on the appearance of the man from the Sudan, Abdullah the Butcher. And he should be moving into that ring momentarily, and I'm sure he'll be accompanied by Precious Paul Ellering. Precious Paul, who's had a sudden reversal of situations here. Abdullah the Butcher. What a massive individual. And is completely devastating when he enters the ring. But boy, he's facing a tough one, too, and Bob Brown. Brown, a powerfully muscular individual. But Abdullah the Butcher wastes no time. Abdullah the Butcher, well over 300 pounds, and Brown hurtled from the ring. And Brown trying to get back on his feet. Brown favoring that right leg, and he's got a massive bruise on the thigh. Abdullah the Butcher catches him once again on the top of the head. Brown brought back into the ring. Members of the press covering this match, Craig Peters on one side from Pro Wrestling Illustrated, George Napolitano on the other side from the main event. There's the bell. It is all over very quickly for one Bob Brown, and Jake the Snake Roberts, unsuccessful in his bid for the national championship, is joining me.
Let's talk about that, all right? You know why I was unsuccessful? Because somebody was sticking their nose into my business. Now, Abdullah's just another man that Paul Ellering has in the stable.
Former champion, special referee for the match, Pistol Pez Whatley. The national tag team title is on the line when the Road Warriors defend against the American Dream, Dusty Rhodes, and his partner, national heavyweight champ, Bret Wayne. Abdullah the Butcher clashes with Mad Dog Buzz Sawyer. The Great Kabuki takes on the Boogie Woogie Man, Jimmy Valiant. The national TV title, Ron Garvin defends against Jake the Snake Roberts, plus two other matches. Action starts 8:30 tonight, the Omni.
Fall or remaining television time. In the red corner, at 313 pounds from Moscow, Russia, Nikolai Volkov. And in the blue corner at 222 pounds from Tulsa, Oklahoma, Mike Reed.
Mike Reed from Tulsa, Oklahoma being introduced. And across the ring is powerful partner from USSR of Russia, Nikolai Volkov. Pee Wee Anderson, the third man in the ring. Andy calls for the bell, and here's Bill.
Well, Mike Reed, since the last time we've seen him on Mid-South, has added quite a few pounds to his body by hard work in the gym. But he is against an awesome machine. He's against a machine, a powerful man, a man who, when he was 17 years old, did a 600-pound one-arm deadlift. A man from a country that you all know, you've seen in recent months just how unscrupulous and heartless they are. People in the Western world seem shocked about it. They shouldn't be shocked. There are things, statements they make that maybe would shock you. You got to realize, it's a communist country. That's an atheist country. They do not fear God. They believe in communism. I heard Nikolai Volkov say it's better to be a boss in hell than a stooge in heaven. And that's exactly the way they feel. They do not respect anything. I'll guarantee you, I'd trade anything to be the lowest servant in heaven rather than the highest officer in that other place. But Nikolai Volkov comes from a place that has torn religion down, torn down everything, and rebuilt it. They believe in the motherland. They believe in the state. And when we think that they are going to have any opinion or any care, they're not. They're out there in the same race to win it all. He says that the United States didn't even have the courage to show up for the Moscow Olympics, the greatest Olympics where the Russians took more combined medals than all the rest of the countries. He's here to bring it right in our own backyard and shove in our face and rub our face in it. Nikolai Volkov. Powerful man. Powerful. 303 pounds. Solid. Mobile. Second week he was here, Boyd Pierce. He attacked Boris Zirkov beat him up and threw him out. Said he was born of Russian parents in the United States. He wasn't from the motherland. He didn't have the beliefs of the motherland. Didn't have the pride. This man says when he wrestles, he not only wrestles for himself, he wrestles for all of the Russians. Driving that boot into the rib area, into the kidney area. Flat of the foot, it's legal. As long as he kicks with the flat of the foot. Look at this power. Look at him. Look at this power. Now look at him. Just hoist this guy back up. He's just awesome. How he can take dead weight and just change it. Oh.
Literally crushing the breath away from him, the powerful Russian Nikolai Volkov gains a victory.
Are the national tag team champions and still undefeated.
That's right. That's the way it's going to stay. Everywhere we go, people get hurt. That's because that's what we're good at, hurting people. We like to hurt people. It's our job. You got to have a lot of guts to get in the ring with us. But another thing you don't have when you get in the ring with us is brains. Because there's no way you're going to win that battle against me and the animal. I think that says it all.
Thank you very much, gentlemen, the national tag team champions. Let me take a moment now to talk to Jake the Snake Roberts and to Precious Paul Ellering.
They're so nice, aren't they? The Road Warriors and myself. We have a lot in common, you see, Gordon. We like to punish people, do things to people that most people wouldn't do. Because this man beside you on your left has provided me with a lot of guidance. He's doing the paperwork now. I do everything in the ring. He's never interfered in one of my matches. Never. And there'll never be the day that he has to. Because I'm not that incompetent. Don't you realize what you're dealing with is something that you people yourselves have made? Realize that when you look at me, you're looking at fear. Some people say you have nothing to fear but fear itself. But I think if you look behind these cold eyes, you'll see more than you can handle.
Oh, the 10-minute time limit in the red corner at 227 pounds from Los Angeles, California, Rip Rogers. And in the blue corner at 237 pounds from Virginia Beach, Virginia, Magnum T.A.
Action continues now. The popular star, Magnum T.A., Terry Allen, as Joel Armstrong calls for the bell. Magnum T.A.'s opponent, the colorful Rip Rogers. Here's Buddy Nichols to tell us about it.
You know, boy, one of the nice things about dealing with sports and athletes is the opportunity to meet young men like Terry Allen, Magnum T.A. I met him just before the matches today, and he's really a very personable young man, one with a lot of wrestling talent, and as we mentioned last week, one with a lot of desire and an opportunity to go a long way in this wrestling business. Right now, Rip Rogers has him with a forearm off the ropes. Magnum T.A. in a little bit of problem. Rip Rogers using the hair, but a nice reversal by Magnum. And again, the hip toss, and Rip Rogers goes down hard. Again, the backflip off the ropes, and Rogers in his colorful lavender tights goes down hard, but he moves out of the way just in time as Magnum tries for the elbow drop. Again, the action hot and heavy here. Again, nice move by Magnum. A strong elbow to the midsection, catching Rogers coming off, and then another one to the chin, and that put Rip Rogers down hard. Takes him high into the air. And the atomic knee drop. And Rogers in a lot of pain as that had to hurt. He pulls up, gets the leverage, and 1, 2, 3. Magnum.
2, 3. Magnum T.A. Terry Allen gains the measure of Rip Rogers here on Mid-South Wrestling.
State try to make themselves $1,000.
I'll tell you one fellow who will try for sure. And I wouldn't be a bit surprised if he succeeded, and that'd be Roddy Piper.
Well, I'm sure that you're right. You know, Roddy's an incredibly strong young man, and there's an awful lot of people here that I'm sure are going to give it a try.
Right now, it is Buzz Sawyer trying his best to totally annihilate David Jones. And as I said before, Jones appears to have quite a future in front of him. But many matches like this one that he's having with Buzz Sawyer, he may get some other thoughts.
Well, it sure is a make or a break situation. If you make it through this, you're going to be a tough kid. This is the type of match with Buzz Sawyer that it's going to test all of the abilities and even then some. You're going to have to really dig down deep, because Bud's the kind of guy that likes to punish people. He likes to keep them on the mat, he likes to wrestle them, and he likes to make sure that when they get done wrestling, they know that they've wrestled the best.
Yeah, and if he doesn't know it today, he'll sure know it tomorrow, because he's going to be sore in the spots where he didn't even know yet. Wow, five verticals to play again, and Jones is all but out on his... didn't allow the pin, had the man.
You know, Buzz has had this running feud with Pistol Pez Watley, and apparently at the moment he's involved with some other things, and Watley, of course, has got his own problems, going after that U.S. heavyweight title, going after some of these bounty hunters that have been sent against him. But Buzz Sawyer doesn't have an easy job either. Tommy Rich is looking for him, wrestling number two, and of course, most recently, we've got a newcomer on the scene, and that's the Junkyard Dog, is making his appearance once again.
And there is... All right, he's got the pinfall on this one. He has the pinfall. Paul Ellering rushing into the ring to congratulate the Mad Dog. And so the victory goes to Mad Dog Buzz Sawyer. We're seeing it in the slow motion once again, as Sawyer had his man pretty well defeated here, brings him up, turns him into a perfect power slam, gets the power slam. You can see the impact, raising them off the canvas, hooks the far leg, has the lateral press, and the victory.
You know, Ollie, we've said in the past we do enjoy hearing from people writing to us, expressing their views and comments about the matches that they see, not only on World Championship Wrestling, but the best of as well. And I thought it might be nice to remind people once again that if they want to come to Atlanta and see the matches live and in person, that can be arranged as well.
Sure, if they call the wrestling office, and I think from time to time we put the numbers and where they can call us. So just be watching right here on TV, and you'll see a number come on the screen, and call down there. We'd be very happy, I should say, to have you come down and watch wrestling while it's being televised here on TV. But there's one other thing that you always say, and that is, if you think wrestling on television is exciting, you haven't seen nothing yet until you come to the matches live, because it really just all comes together and it's really exciting in person.
No question about it. We'll be back with you again next week. On behalf of Ole Anderson, Gordon Soley saying so long.
Announcers on this program are employed by Georgia Championship Wrestling Incorporated.
Thank you. Thank you so very much, and welcome to another hour of World Championship Wrestling. We've got lots and lots of things to talk about and to do today. First of all, let's take a look at this trophy. We've got a trophy, and at the top of that trophy, in an upcoming tag team tournament, there will be $50,000 in the top. And, well, as I say, the trophy is immediately to my right. We'll be taking, there you see it. This trophy is... close to 5 feet tall, and there will be $50,000 in that trophy for the winner of the upcoming tag team tournament. More about that later on. Right now, though, let me bring in Ole Anderson, because a strange turn of events starting last week with Buzz Sawyer, and certainly this man has completed a turnabout that I think amazed everybody but pleased everybody.
Well, it's amazed everybody, and certainly I hope that it's a permanent one, and I think that there are some people that are going to be in for a surprise, because a guy like Sawyer isn't one to be denied, and he feels as though he's got a purpose, and I'm very happy to see that change. As concerns his brother, Brett Wayne, we know that what kind of a kid he is. He just never says die, and for that reason, he's been directed by the NWA, Bob Geigel, stay at home, because we tried to talk to him, and the kid is in just such an emotional state right now. He's had his hand severely injured at the hands of the Road Warriors, and the best thing to do is just keep him off the TV. I tried to talk to Buzz, And he guarantees me that he will contain himself and try to conduct himself with dignity, which is for Buzz to be kind of quiet. I think that's very unusual. And when I talk to him, he's talking in a normal tone of voice, very subdued. And you know what they say sometimes, still waters run deep. And I think finally that we've gotten to Buzz Sawyer, and I think it's a good sign.
I do, too. Another strange twist and turn of events has occurred, too, when you're talking about the Road Warriors. And we'll be seeing it a little bit later on, but it's quite obvious that Mr. Ellering has rejoined forces with the Road Warriors.
Well, things hit the bottom of the barrel, and apparently Ellering and the Road Warriors, the Snake, they're all at the bottom of the barrel, and that's where they belong, and they can all be together. I want to mention here right now that we also have a very piece of film that was taken by somebody and sent to us here in a situation that just happened concerning Tommy Rich. Somebody is after Tommy Rich. We've got that clip that was sent to us, and we thought this would be the time to show it and just let the people see right away. We don't know who, but I think the film clip is self-explanatory.
I think it is indeed. Let's go to that right now. Mask and Tommy Rich caught totally unawares on a full power slam. It's difficult to determine because the person is wearing street clothes, but it's not difficult to figure out that he's an extremely powerful individual.
Well, as you know, Tommy has been going after the world's title. Tommy has been going with a partner after the tag team titles held by the Road Warriors. And Tommy is certainly to be considered and reckoned with. Here we have a man that comes into the ring at a match, not scheduled, don't know who he is, with a mask. And Tommy, at this point, as we can see, is trying to take that mask off. But the film will stop here in just a moment, and we still won't know who he is.
Well, the interesting thing, too, and may I just suggest this to all of you who may be watching, don't ever jump into a ring, because, my friend, you're putting yourself in great jeopardy, as this man, whoever he was, has put himself into. I have a hunch, however, that he is a professional competitor.
I'm sure of it, but the thing is, and the important point is, as Tommy said, he was unsuccessful in his attempt to hurt Tommy, because if you take a look right now, you'll see who's in that ring.
The Omni in Atlanta, the 8th annual Thanksgiving Super Spectacular. 30 wrestlers at the Omni participating in the biggest one-night tag team tournament in history. $50,000 to the winning team, plus these matches. Revenge match, the Road Warriors against Mad Dog Buzz Sawyer, seeking revenge for his brother Brett. Buzz may wrestle without a partner. No disqualification when Ted DiBiase clashes with Wildfire Tommy Rich. TV title, Jake the Snake Roberts defends the new belt he won against Mr. Wrestling 2. Ladies match, Donna Day against Debbie Combs, plus such world-famous tag teams in the tournament as the Asian champions, the Mongolians, Hacksaw Butch Reed and Pistol Pez Watley, the Bruise Brothers, Big Jim Duggan and Ron Garvin, the 770-pound team, King Kong Bundy and Anvil Hart, Magnum T.A. and Randy Savage, it's Volkoff and Chernko, Rose and Randolph, and more, going for $50,000 in a fantastic one-night tournament. Thanksgiving night, 8 o'clock, the Omni. Be there!
One fall, 10-minute time limit. Tracy Storer in the blue trunk up against Ted DiBiase. DiBiase with a good duck under and go behind. DiBiase punishing Storer. All right, DiBiase circling his man, watching him carefully. DiBiase, a changed individual from his earlier days in professional wrestling. He has become a man who considers winning at any cost is worth the effort.
Well, there's no question about it. He's a good wrestler. He was a terrific amateur athlete, but he's made his stated goals, and those are to become the heavyweight champion. And he makes no bones about it. He's not interested in being friendly with anybody. He's interested only in winning. On the one hand, I agree with the winning part, but as we've seen, I think that certainly maybe it takes time for people to mature, but there are more important things than just winning at all costs.
Words well put by Ole Anderson. DiBiase in behind his man now with a rear chin lock has Tracy Storer in trouble. DiBiase, an intense competitor, keeps a lot of pressure on his opponents at all times. He is a second-generation competitor. his late father, Iron Mike DiBiase, one of the all-time greats. And Ted DiBiase certainly trying to follow in those footsteps, but as Ole and I were just discussing, he now considers winning the most important thing in his life. Tracy Storr in trouble.
Well, it looks awful tough for Tracy Storr. DiBiase has just got him in too many ways. He's bigger, he's stronger, and he's got more experience. And the thing that you've got to look at Tracy Storr is just that he shows a lot of guts just getting in the ring with the guy and trying to hang in there.
And it is Storr, and he caught his head on the ring apron. And I might point out that that ring is ribbed in steel all the way around. And Storr took the entire brunt of that. DiBiase.
Enough, I thought we were going to have some problem on the floor. And DiBiase, knowing that he's got his man, just came out and threw him back in the ring, almost as if to say, I'm trying to help the guy. Well, DiBiase doesn't impress me as a kind of guy that's going to try to help anybody.
I think he perhaps may have been worrying. He knows Nick Patrick and what kind of a referee is. He could have been worried that he was going to be disqualified, and that could go on his win-loss record.
I think you're right. He's had a taste of suspension, and I don't think he likes it.
Didn't allow the pin. Could have very easily. Should have, as a matter of fact, but he didn't allow the pin. And he is within his parameters here, unfortunately. And Storr trying to battle his way back, but I would say that
he's on his feet. You know, he's just operating on what instinct he has left. And of course, DiBiase, once again, he's smart. He knows pulling the guy back up by the hair. He's got a count of five, and as long as he can get loose of the guy before that count of five comes up, as you say, everything he does is legal.
Precisely. He's well within it. And I might point out that you see him once again caught him coming off the rope. And so it is DiBiase very much in control of the entire situation. A full power slam by Ted DiBiase. And now DiBiase softening him up. Spinning toe hold into that figure four leg lock, and brother, that is all she wrote. I'll guarantee that Storr, and he does, he concedes very quickly. So, and DiBiase now hanging in there, continuing to punish his man. And there again is that sadistic streak in DiBiase.
He sure has got one. I think we're going to have that on film.
All right, coming off the ropes, you see how DiBiase catches him coming in, full power slam down to the canvas. Now DiBiase still not satisfied. Storr is obviously stunned. DiBiase moves very quickly into the spinning toe hold, and from the spinning toe hold then locks down with the figure four leg lock, and it's all over.
The 8th Annual Thanksgiving Super Spectacular. 30 wrestlers at the Omni participating in the biggest one-night tag team tournament in history. $50,000 to the winning team. Plus these matches. Revenge match. The Road Warriors against Mad Dog Buzz Sawyer. Seeking revenge for his brother Brett. Buzz may wrestle without a partner. No disqualification when Ted DiBiase clashes with Wildfire Tommy Rich. TV title, Jake the Snake Roberts defends the new belt he won against Mr. Wrestling 2. Ladies match, Donna Day against Debbie Combs. Plus such world-famous tag teams in the tournament as the Asian champions, the Mongolians, Hacksaw Butch Reed and Pistol Pez Watley, the Bruise Brothers, Big Jim Duggan and Ron Garvin, the 770-pound team, King Kong Bundy and Anvil Hart, Magnum T.A. and Randy Savage, it's Volkoff and Chernko, Rose and Randolph, and more, going for $50,000 in a fantastic one-night tournament. Thanksgiving night, 8 o'clock, the Omni. Be there!
Well, Anderson, about the fact that we've got a just a host of great new competitors heading this way.
Well, there's an awful lot of people coming down here. The talent is just tremendous. A lot of tag teams coming this way. A lot of single individuals that are coming down here. In fact, we're going to see one of those men right now by way of VTR, and his name is Magnum T.A.
Right. And I'll tell you what we'll do. If somebody will push number B program over there on the monitor, we'll take a look at Magnum T.A. in action. Magnum T.A. moving out against the Super Destroyer. Introductions being made at this time. And there you see him, Magnum T.A., Terry Allen. He is out of Virginia. Didn't begin his athletic career until he was about 14 years old, Ole, and
Then he became very, very athletically inclined, and from there went on to high school and collegiate competitive competition, and has turned out to be just a fantastic athlete.
Well, he's a good one, and of course, I don't want to discount the man that he's wrestling right there, the Super Destroyer, because he's also a great amateur. And again, when we're watching right here, we see the amateur moves that they're both using. Both men quick, both men fast. Super Destroyer may be outweighing Terry Allen by about 30 or 40 pounds, but yet Super Destroyer is moving quickly. Terry Allen may be moving just a little bit quicker.
I think that's a point well made. A headbutt now by the Super Destroyer has Allen. Magnum T.A. is suddenly stunned, but he fires him off the ropes, catches him. A good shoulder smash by the Super Destroyer has Allen back to the canvas once again. And a good leapfrog up and over his man and retaliates with a good drop kick.
Well, I tell you, that Allen really shows a lot of promise. He's a heck of a kid, and it's, again, kind of reminiscent of Brett Wayne. I've seen him before, and he's really blossomed lately, really coming along. He's got a tremendous athletic background and ability, as you mentioned. And we see here in the ring that he's a kid that's really something to be reckoned with. Anytime that you can hold the Super Destroyer at bay, you've done something.
Yeah, this is, frankly, a match that would be a main event anywhere in the United States. No question about that. Two superior athletes locked in combat here. And right now, the Super Destroyer beginning to show exactly what he's made of. Terry Allen having his problems now. And coming off the ropes once again, high backdrop that has Allen back to the canvas. He was able to partially block that by getting those feet down early, but not enough to stop from the punishment that he's now taking at the hands of the Super Destroyer.
When you're wrestling a big kid like the Super D there, you've just got to rely on your speed and your quickness. And this is where Terry Allen, I think, may have made a little mistake. He tried to go in after Super D and tried to match him strength to strength, pound for pound. He just can't do it. He's got to go back. He's got to rely on that speed. He's got to rely on the quickness and his ability maybe to just move just a little bit quicker, as you're saying.
Trying to set his man here for a high. So it looked like he was going for a souple, but instead brought him up to the top rope. But Terry Allen rips away at the mask in the face of the Super Destroyer. And as the Super Destroyer moves in, Allen leapfrogs up over his man, catches him with a hard right hand and a good forearm. Another one to the side of the head. And the Super Destroyer's got his problems now as Allen catches him with a high hip toss coming off the ropes. Brings him up once again. And here's the thing about Terry Allen. And he is perpetual motion. He's constantly in action.
Well, that makes it for him. That's what really makes him different, and that's what makes him a winner, because he does go like that. He just, as you say, non-stop action with Terry Allen.
110% at all times brings him up. An atomic knee drop has the Super Destroyer back to the canvas. That jarred the spine, gave him a three count, and it is over for the Super Destroyer. A fine victory for Magnum T.A. That is Magnum Terry Allen, and there's certainly no question about the fact that this man does have, indeed, Magnum force. Talking about tag teams, too, there's another tag team combination that's most unusual.
Well, we saw their name on the screen. We're talking about the Bruise Brothers. Boy, I'll tell you, when I saw them, I just couldn't believe it. You take a look, you're going to see an interview by the Bruise Brothers and their manager, Jimmy Hart. It's something else.
Let's go to that right now.
Now, I know what you're saying. You're saying, who in the world is Jimmy Hart and the Bruise Brothers? Well, you see this little picture right here. This is a million-seller album that Jimmy Hart had out back in 1972 when I was in the Omni. I keep on dancing, boy. Jimmy Hart is.